Welcome to the next part of our video series on low-energy ion scattering. This time we will focus on the in-depth information provided by this technique. First of all, LEIS determines the elemental composition of the outermost atomic layer. This is done by scattering noble gas ions off of the surface atoms and measuring the energy loss in this collision. From the energy loss, the mass of the surface atom can be determined. Since the noble gas ions have a strong driving force for neutralization, only a fraction is still ionized after the collision and can be detected. This is the reason for the ultimate surface sensitivity, which is the main feature of LEIS. Together with the fact that it is quantitative, its ability to measure very rough and insulating samples, and its good detection limits, make it a valuable tool for surface analysis, for example for heterogeneous catalysis. Besides the elemental composition of the outer layer, spectra also contain information about the in-depth signal of the elements. This information is gained without any sputtering, thus avoiding the corresponding artifacts. This makes LEIS especially suited for ultra-thin analysis. The thinner, the better. In addition to the process of scattering at the outer surface, which was responsible for the peaks in the spectrum, another process takes place, scattering at an atom in deeper layers. For this to happen, the ion has to penetrate the surface, travel to the atom, scatter, again with an energy loss given by the scattering formula, travel back to the surface and leave the solid. The energy after leaving the solid is given by two components. Firstly, the energy loss characteristic for the atom that caused the scattering event, and secondly, the energy loss for moving the primary ion through the solid, which is proportional to the depth of the scattering event. That means that an ion scattered below the surface is registered with an energy smaller than ion scattered from an atom of the same element at the surface. The element-specific energy loss is the same, but depending on the depth, additional energy is lost. This forms the low-energy tails to the left of the peaks, corresponding to the in-depth distribution of the element, for example, marked by zirconium depth in the shown figure. We also have to consider the charge state of the primary ions. Once the noble gas ion enters the solid, it is neutralized due to its large ionization potential. An electron in the solid will always gain energy by neutralizing the noble gas ion. Consequently, the projectile travels through the solid in a neutral state. Only when leaving the solid does it have a chance of being re-ionized and detected. The probability of re-ionization is always smaller than the survival probability of noble gas ions scattered at the surface. This is the reason why the surface peaks are more intense than the tails from the scattering by atoms below the surface. Reionization is promoted by certain elements in the surface, most importantly by oxygen. Therefore, the intensity of the in-depth signal is not quantitative. The shape, however, especially the width which corresponds to the thickness of the film, is quantitative. A conversion from energy loss, which equals the width of the tail, to thickness of the film can be done using SRIM or experimental calibration. For 3 kV helium, a width of 90 eV corresponds to 1 nanometer of organic film, and a width between 130 and 160 eV corresponds to an inorganic or oxide film. These effects are most prominent for helium scattering. For neon and argon primary ions, the tails are of no analytical significance. In this slide, we see experimental data from zirconium oxide films grown by ALD on silicon dioxide. The number of ALD deposition cycles corresponds to the amount of material deposited. With increasing number of cycles, the surface peak of zirconium, representative for zirconium oxide, increases, while the silicon peak is decreasing. This means the surface area covered by zirconium oxide is growing, but even after 70 cycles, less than 100% of the surface is covered by the zirconium oxide. Only after 100 cycles is the silicon peak completely gone. With the increasing number of deposition cycles, we also see a tail to the left of the zirconium peak develop. This indicates that prior to the formation of a closed film, part of the material is growing in multilayers. If we look at the blue spectrum for 40 cycles, we see about 50% surface coverage from the intensity of the surface peak. At the same time, we see a tail which extends more than 200 eV to lower energies, corresponding to more than 1.5 nanometers of thickness. This means that while about 50% of the surface is still not covered, parts of the covered area are up to 1.5 nanometers thick. The black spectrum shows a very pronounced tail to the left, even horizontal for several hundred eV. This, in addition to the absence of silicon, indicates a closed film. For the red spectrum, 70 cycles, directly to the left of the surface peak, the intensity of the tail is lower than that of the black spectrum, indicating that for the first few angstroms below the surface, the coverage is less than 100% and drops quickly. However, a significant part of the 70 cycles film is about 2 nanometers thick, deduced from the high intensity of the tail reaching 300 EV to the left of the surface peak. In this way, the evolution of film growth can be assessed while at the same time monitoring the layer coverage. Here we see a second example, this time tungsten deposition on silicon oxide. 3 different layers of 7.5, 10, and 15 angstroms were deposited using 2 different deposition processes. As the samples were transported through air, they have a native oxide and atmospheric contamination present. In order to remove this absorbed hydrocarbon contamination, treatment with atomic oxygen is performed. Since the outer surface is already in the highest oxidation state due to the air exposure, further oxidation is not possible, so the oxidizing treatment will have no effect on the outer layer of the sample. Using 3 keV helium scattering, only the expected elements are detected. No contaminant is found. All tungsten films are closed and a silicon peak is only detected on the sample prior to deposition. The tungsten peak is accompanied by a low energy tail, the tungsten in-depth signal. Due to the oxidation of the tungsten close to the surface, the intensity of the tungsten in-depth signal is reduced, forming the dip directly to the left of the tungsten surface peak. In the first approximately 1 nanometer, the tungsten density is reduced due to the presence of oxygen. Comparing the samples from the 2 different process conditions, only a small difference is detected. The in-depth signals almost overlap. By determining the width of the in-depth signal, the film thickness can be derived and plotted for both sets of samples. Both sets of samples have significantly thicker films than the nominal values, indicated by the grey line. But the difference between the corresponding samples of the 2 sets is very small. This demonstrates the sensitivity of LEIS for small variations in layer thickness. In summary, in addition to the composition of the outermost atomic layer, LEIS provides the in-depth information of the elements over the first few nanometers of the sample. This information is gained without sputtering the sample, and by avoiding sputtering artifacts, this approach is ideally suited for the analysis of ultra-thin layers, even those below a nanometer in thickness. The thinner the film, the more sensitive LEIS is to small variations in layer thickness. For more information, please visit www.iontof.com/qtech.